DeFi 2.0. There's a few things you may not know about it. Let's get into it. So you just wet your toes into the world of DeFi, and Discord and Twitter is already full of DeFi 2.0 chatter. So what the hell is DeFi 2.0 anyways? Here are 5 things you don't know about DeFi 2.0. But first, my name is Trev, and here at CoinMarketCap, we love making videos about all things crypto, from market moves to crypto news and to educational videos just like the one that you're watching right now. So if you're interested in more videos just like this one, make sure to subscribe down below. And anyways, guys, let's just get right into the video. As you already know, DeFi or decentralized finance comprises all the decentralized alternatives to our existing financial world. The difference between DeFi protocols and traditional financial services is that DeFi doesn't require intermediaries. Instead, DeFi uses blockchain technology to cut out all of those expensive middlemen like banks, brokers, and stock exchanges. And in the past year, we've watched DeFi go from a fringe idea to a colossal business. Right now, the total value locked into DeFi protocols is hovering around the $250 billion mark, and the global market cap for all DeFi tokens is just under $150 billion. Yes, these figures are impressive, but to put them into context, the global derivatives market contains an estimated $1 quadrillion. So DeFi still has a way to go before we can even start making any meaningful comparisons to traditional finance. Still, the DeFi 1.0 protocols available to us now offer an impressive wide array of financial services already. We've got decentralized lending protocols like MakerDAO, which enables you to put your crypto up as collateral in exchange for less volatile assets like stablecoins. There are derivatives platforms like Synthetix that issue synthetic assets, allowing for the creation of crypto indexes like the DeFi index. And of course, we have decentralized exchanges or DEXs like Uniswap and PancakeSwap. DEXs allow you to create your own liquidity pools or contribute liquidity to a pool in exchange for a share of the transaction fees, among other features. However, given DeFi's success, it's pretty easy to overlook the problems our DeFi 1.0 protocols are up against, problems which DeFi 2.0 seek to address. So without further ado, let's take a look at 5 things you don't know about DeFi 2.0. So that brings us to our first point, which is DeFi 2.0 aims to provide long-term liquidity. Once the sun set on the summer of DeFi back in 2020, it became abundantly clear that DeFi had a huge obstacle to overcome, a persistent lack of long-term sustainable liquidity. To answer why, we have to look at how most DeFi platforms get their liquidity in the first place, which is through incentivized liquidity mining. Liquidity mining involves third parties like you and me lending our tokens to a protocol in exchange for an incentive. If you've ever staked or lent your crypto assets to a DeFi platform and received some of the platform's native tokens, you've received a liquidity mining incentive. The assets we lend act as the platform's liquidity and enable it to offer all of the usual DeFi stuff like collateralized borrowing and token trading. And as DeFi has become more prosperous and competitive over time, up-and-coming protocols have started offering higher and higher rewards to lure more liquidity. But this is actually completely unsustainable. But why? Because eventually and inevitably, the platform runs out of rewards to even give out. Or if its rewards has an uncapped supply, the protocol disperses so many tokens that its value can never even rise. The crux of the matter is that you and me and all of the other liquidity providers aren't contracted to keep our liquidity in the pool. We can cash out whenever we feel like it, which is usually around the time that the rewards dry up. And when that happens, the whales are the first to cash out, which drains all of the protocol's liquidity. Then the protocol's native token inevitably crashes, and then we can all move on to the next shiny DeFi protocol. There are countless examples of this exact situation to further illustrate this problem, but the one that stands out above the rest is a DeFi platform called Titan. On June 16th, 2021, Titan's token was trading steadily at a respectable $65. But sometime during the evening, Titan whales began dumping their tokens en masse, one after another. By midday the following day, the price of a single Titan token had crashed to a 0.0000024, and all but the first few whales that had cashed out were badly burned. And the damage wasn't limited to rookie investors. Even the veteran billionaire investor Mark Cuban took a hit. And this lack of sustainable liquidity has been a thorn in DeFi's side for a while now.
but a couple platforms have developed some innovative and interesting ways to solve this issue. As such, they have been wildly praised as the new wave of DeFi 2.0 protocols. And one of these new potential DeFi 2.0 protocols is Olympus. So what does Olympus do differently? Instead of using the liquidity mining incentives relied upon by DeFi 1.0 protocols, Olympus owns 99.5% of its liquidity, a concept called protocol-controlled liquidity, or PCL. By owning all of its liquidity, Olympus makes it more and more difficult for a pod of crypto whales to dump their positions all at once and crash the token's value. Olympus achieves this by using what is called a decentralized reserve currency called OHM. Right now, OHM tokens are backed by a treasury, which is owned and controlled by Olympus and has a balance of more than $750 million. Each individual OHM token is backed by at least one DAI, an Ethereum-based stablecoin, which gives each token a price floor of at least $1. But each OHM token is actually backed by much, much more than just $1. Currently, OHM tokens are backed by around $150 worth of assets, which is mostly made up of DAI, FRAX, LUSD, and ETH. And right now it's in its early stages, but if protocol-controlled liquidity keeps on working, it could become the DeFi 2.0 standard. And we also have an upcoming video on DeFi 2.0, which includes a more detailed look at exactly how the Olympus protocol actually works.
And that brings us to the second point, which is DeFi 2.0 won't rely on fiat-backed stablecoins. As you're no doubt aware, DeFi platforms rely heavily on stablecoins, most of which are backed by the US dollar. But this flies in the face of what DeFi is really all about. DeFi is supposed to move us away from inflationary centralized currencies like the dollar. DeFi is not supposed to be a digital duplicate of our existing financial services, and for now, fiat-backed stablecoins are integral to DeFi 1.0 protocols. So how can DeFi 2.0 get around this problem? This is an area where a number of possible DeFi 2.0 protocols like Alchemix, Fei Protocol, and Olympus DAO have been innovating. To use Olympus decentralized reserve currency OHM as an example again, OHM works just like a stablecoin, but it isn't a stablecoin because it's not pegged to a stable asset. Instead, it's a free-floating reserve currency backed by a basket of assets. And the basket of assets, in Olympus's case, is its treasury. Moving away from fiat-backed stablecoins will take a long time, but Olympus seems to be leading the way so far. But other DeFi protocols are creating new and even more efficient sustainable replacements for stablecoins all the time.
And the next point is that DeFi 2.0 will be more decentralized. One of the most common gripes to hear about DeFi is the lack of true decentralization, which is a fair point as the word decentralized is right there in the name. Since DeFi has grown in popularity, we've seen increasing numbers of protocols move over to a DAO operating structure, which has gone some way to addressing this concern. As I'm sure you're already aware, DAOs or decentralized autonomous organizations are managed and owned by their community of token holders, not by a decentralized company or a boardroom of directors. Anyone holding the required quantity of a DAO's governance token can propose changes to the DAO and vote on changes proposed by other DAO members. By adopting a DAO structure, DeFi protocols can offer a more and more democratic way to organize and operate while simultaneously addressing the centralization concerns of DeFi users. As you've no doubt noticed, a number of popular DeFi platforms now function as decentralized autonomous organizations, or DAOs, including MakerDAO, Uniswap, and a few DeFi 2.0 contenders like Olympus already use a DAO structure as well. And still, there's a large number of DeFi protocols which have yet to adopt a decentralized structure. But as we start to move into a DeFi 2.0 era, DAOs will likely become a more common structure for DeFi protocols, or maybe even the norm.
And that brings us to our last point, which is DeFi 2.0 will lower user costs and offer a superior user experience. If you've used any DeFi protocol, you know that it can be both expensive and difficult to navigate. Clearly, reducing the cost for using DeFi services and improving the user experience would be an important step on the road to mainstream adoption. So why have we grouped them together? Well, before we see any lower costs and a better user experience across the DeFi space, two changes need to happen. First, DeFi protocols must adopt a more sustainable way to source their liquidity, the reasons for which we covered in part one of this video. If you've watched part one of this video, you already know why this is so important. And the second change that we need to see is Ethereum 2.0 going live. Why? Well, because right now the vast majority of DeFi protocols run on Ethereum. And Ethereum, as we know, suffers from low transactions and high gas fees, and also low scalability. But all that is set to change with Ethereum 2.0, which we are expecting to go live sometime next year. Ethereum 2.0 should reduce gas fees, speed up transaction times, and make DeFi protocols built on Ethereum much more easier to scale. And once transactions on DeFi protocols become faster and cheaper, they become more accessible to many, many more people. Among the crowd of new DeFi users, you can expect to see a lot of first-time crypto users, many of whom are currently priced out of DeFi. But if they're not priced out, they might be avoiding DeFi for another reason, which is they don't understand how to use DeFi. And while Web 3.0 wallets like MetaMask have gone a long way making DeFi more accessible, even crypto natives still make mistakes like sending a token to the wrong network. Still, these products and services are improving all of the time and are making DeFi incrementally easier to navigate every single day. For example, MetaMask is trialing a new wallet, purpose-built for institutional investors called MetaMask Institutional, which might go some way to bringing more institutional investment to DeFi. So the combination of a sustainable liquidity sourcing across DeFi and the improvements expected from Ethereum 2.0 will provide a better and cheaper user experience during the DeFi 2.0 era. Anyways, guys, that's been 5 things you don't know about DeFi 2.0. I've been your host, Trev, and if you have any questions, just ask Alex in the description below. And also, if you learned anything, make sure to comment that down below in the comment section, as we're always eager to hear your feedback. We'll catch you in the next one. See you later.